Leading Education Towards Successful Teaching and Lasting Knowledge, or Let's Talk, is a podcast that discusses relevant topics and issues in education management and governance. Hosted by Dr. Evelie Serrano, Dr. Monica Walet, and Dr. Emely Dicolen, Let's Talk is an extension initiative of the Institute for Governance and Rural Development, College of Public Affairs and Development, University of the Philippines, Las Baños. Dr. Evelie is an associate professor and the director of IGRTC PATH. An education enthusiast and lifelong learner, she is passionate about improving the quality of teaching and learning through teacher training and education. An assistant professor at IGRTC PATH, Dr. Monica has occupied academic and leadership positions in higher education institutions in the Philippines and Singapore. A registered psychologist, she is a well-known mental health advocate and speaker who designs and facilitates training programs aimed at promoting mental health and well-being. Dr. Emely is an associate professor and currently the college secretary of UP Manila's National Teacher Training Center for the Health Professions. A dynamic administrator and education manager, she has introduced innovative programs and projects in various institutions of higher learning. Let's Talk! Every Wednesday on the UPLB College of Public Affairs and Development Facebook page, as we lead education towards successful teaching and lasting knowledge.
Welcome to the third episode of Let's Talk. This is Emely, and joining me once again are my co-members of the BWP, mga babaeng walang pahinga, Dr. Evelie and Dr. Monica. Ayan, na sila po ulit ang makakasama natin sa ating podcast. Nabitin ba kayo sa aming previous episode? Don't worry, kasi mahaba-haba po ang ating usapan ngayon. Kaya, kumusta naman kaya ang ating mga ka-Let's Talkers? Kumusta naman kayo?
Ay, philosophical question ba ito? Well, I think, therefore, I am. In other words, buhay pa, Kesh!
Na pinagdadaanan natin ngayon, pwede rin Miss Universe question yan. Tough question, but all in all, we're doing good naman po. Struggling, pero fight lang.
Wow, ang gaganda ng mga sagot. Kaya kayo na po ang humusga, no? Kung sino ang mag-uuwi ng corona sa ating episode na ito. And you know, I'm really happy to know that you're both doing good, no? In our previous episode, you know, we talked about the perceived impact of remote learning to our students. And one of the new concepts that we have learned was about task switching. It is when we direct our attention from one task to another and then back again.
That's right. Kaya no matter how much we rationalize that we are actually multitasking, that is basically task switching. So we have already lost focus, and if it would take more time or even another push of energy to even go back to what we are supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm, tama. And isa lang po ito sa mga nararanasan ng mga students at ganun din, no, ang mga teachers during remote teaching and learning. And I'm sure marami pang ibang impacts ang remote learning sa ating mga guro. And so therefore, in this episode, we will be talking about the perceived impact of remote learning to teachers. Hindi lingid sa ating mga kaalaman na hindi lamang po mga estudyante ang apektado sa remote teaching and learning. Sabi ko nga sa nakaraang episode natin, tayo ding mga guro ay apektado. So, matanong ko lang kayo, Dr. Evelyn, Dr. Monica, anong naging reaction ninyo when remote learning was first introduced?
Like any responses to changes or abrupt changes, it was really overwhelming. Although I had previous experiences in online teaching, mostly in a small number of students, coaching them on their coursework and responding to students' questions or inquiries through emails and simple learning management systems. In Singapore, no, as early as 2010, our institution was already into Moodle, Blackboard. And sometime in 2015, yun nga, inintroduce na sa amin yung Google Classroom. But with the pandemic, the educational response is to really to shift to emergency teaching or remote teaching. At nasa Pilipinas na ako noon. And I remember I had to reskill, rewire, revise various teaching strategies to be able to teach and transfer learning remotely. Daming challenges, but I viewed this as more of opportunities. Dami ko pa yung certificate of attendance or participation in webinars on teaching and assessment. I have to say, upgraded ba ang skills ko, no? Gained more confidence in video conferencing and teaching in general.
Ako naman, I must admit that at first I had some apprehensions. While ICT is not new to me, it was going to be the first time that I'll be facilitating remote learning, which at first I assumed was more of online teaching. As I had never experienced remote learning before, my bias was towards face-to-face classes. But it excited me in a way, as it is something new. And as I have learned more about the approaches, as well as the apps and the tools in remote learning and teaching, it excited me even more. And it challenged me more as well because I realized the possibilities and I thought this remote learning setup could level up my ability to teach. So yes, nag-worry din ako sa challenges, among which unreliable internet connection, students' participation and all. But I agree with Dr. Monica that these challenges can also be opportunities. In the end, ganun nga nangyari. So we were able to transform these challenges into opportunities to make teaching and learning more responsive and inclusive.
So that means that I think common naman yung experience natin na at first we were overwhelmed, no, there were challenges, but eventually natuto naman tayo, we got used to it, no. Pero Dr. Evelie, as an administrator, how did you prepare your faculty members for this modality of teaching and learning?
I'm so grateful, Dr. Emely, that UP provided us the support that we needed, from the various webinars to the internet subsidy to the provision of laptops. May pautang pa through the UP Provident Fund to purchase computers. Oo. Laking tulong talaga yung mga yon.
True.
At as regards the webinars, they were very helpful because only a few of us, particularly our colleagues who are also teaching at UP Open University, had prior experience in remote learning. Nevertheless, challenging pa rin kahit may experience ka with remote learning and teaching kasi while the teacher may have been ready for remote learning and teaching, some students were not. So the faculty members had to learn how to really manage effectively the remote learning setup given all the limitations and challenges. That entailed getting the feedback of students. So our institute, the Institute for Governance and Rural Development, with the help of the Knowledge Management Office of CIPAF, conducted a survey on the students' perceptions of the remote teaching and learning setup, no, at CIPAF. We presented the results of the survey in a learning session with our faculty members, and we used the findings as a basis in improving our course packs and the way we facilitate our classes.
Ah, I agree, Dr. Evelie. Talaga, napakalaking tulong din naman talaga ng UP, no? Dahil hindi lang sa mga trainings tayo tinulungan, but even with the gadgets that we need. And alam mo, I really believe, no, that leadership support is very important during this transition.
Yes, I agree.
Dr. Monica, you were still with your former school when we transitioned to remote teaching and learning, no? Now, did your institution prepare you?
Ay nako, commendable ang former institution ko. Wala akong masabi. And one thing good about this school or college ay meron ng innovation lab. And so, when the pandemic struck, the institution was able to take the traction to the big shift.
Wow, talaga namang advanced nga pala yung former school mo, no? Wow. Anyway, alam nyo, in an article I read, no, it says that some teachers are actually complaining, no, about the short time given them to prepare, of course, themselves, no, for remote learning. Kasi nga naman, di ba, after the lockdown, nag-announce na agad ng reopening of classes and teachers had to rush writing their modules, their course packs, even yung mga trainings, no, for online learning. Did you go through the same experience?
Yes, the time to prepare was really short. Our experience, however, revealed how resilient and resourceful our teachers are. It also showed us that with the right support, despite the short preparation time and all the challenges, it's possible to transition to another teaching and learning setup. Kaya saludo talaga ako sa mga teacher who demonstrated resilience and strength as we transitioned to remote learning and teaching. Major adjustment yun for many of us. Kaya expected din talaga na maraming reklamo.
Well, I guess we have to understand where our teachers are coming from. Mm-hmm. Not all are techie and of the same generation, di ba?
Yes.
So, and exposure to modern technology. So, sa iba, may resistance sa ganitong shift. But I think no, majority of the teachers saw naman the value of online teaching kesa naman magkaroon ng stoppage or discontinuation of learning. Meron din namang difficulties which the school management need to address talaga.
Siyempre, no? Hindi ako spared from the struggle. Sabi nga nila, the struggle is real.
Oo, kahit si Darna napapagod, Dr. Emely.
Kaya sa'yo na ang bato.
Yes, sa akin na ang bato. Sa akin na ang corona. Halos di kaya ako matulog noon sa paggawa ng aking mga course packs. Pero anyway, so alam nyo, given this scenario, ano kaya? Ano kaya naman yung mga negative impact ng remote learning?
Alam nyo, may impact talaga sa mental health and overall well-being. Extra challenge na nga kasi to teach in a setup that we are not used to. And we had to do that pa in the midst of a global health crisis. So talagang nakakapagod, lalo na nung simula while we were adjusting. Kakaibang pagod yun, recalling the first couple of months of remote learning. Both teachers and students had to adjust talaga.
Mm-hmm. O nga eh, sa experience ko rin, ano, mostly yung connectivity issues, intermittent Wi-Fi, at no, having to handle passive students. Alam nyo, ang hirap mag-motivate ng mga estudyante, para bang hindi mo alam, andun pa ba sila? Para kasi ang kausap mo, mga icons or pictures, and then of course, no, yung tinatawag nilang Zoom fatigue or webinar fatigue, ay nakaka-experience talaga tayo. So nakaka-stress, nakakapagod, given the limited context of the interaction during this remote teaching and learning.
Tama ka, Doc Monique. Nakaka-stress naman talaga at nakakapagod. Ako personally, yung physical exhaustion, ibang level. Kasi lalo na ako, kilala nyo naman ako, gusto ko kapag nagtuturo ako, yung laging nga sa performance level ako. So, pag sa face-to-face, exhausting na yon. Kasi meron akong talagang target energy level. Pero itong remote teaching and learning, lalo na yung online synchronous classes, iba din. Parang doble ang pagod. Kaya in terms of my self-efficacy as a teacher, feeling ko nababawasan. Kasi I'm used to talking to face-to-face. Tapos ngayon, small squares of faces lang ang nasa screen ko. Do you also have that feeling? O ako lang?
Okay naman din yan. Ano? We all may be experiencing what you're actually experiencing. Pero Doc Ems, explain mo nga yung sinasabi mong self-efficacy. Kasi ang pagkakaalam ko dyan, it's an individual's belief in his or her capability or capacity to execute desired behavior. So are you referring to your efficiency also as a teacher?
Actually, Doc Monique, when I say self-efficacy, yun yung feeling ko na nakukulangan ba ako sa mismong sarili ko dahil ang pakiramdam ko, hindi ko na ibibigay yung learning, no, and competencies na kailangang matutunan ng mga estudyante ko, yun yung ibig ko sabihin. Kasi diba, unlike kapag face-to-face, nakikita mo yung mga estudyante mo, tumatango, nakatitig sa'yo, or umiiling kapag hindi ka nila maintindihan. So, you get that affirmation, no, from them directly kung natututo sila o hindi. Ito yung sobrang limited kasi when it comes to remote teaching and learning.
Same here. I also felt that since hindi mo makita ang reaction ng mga students dahil naka-off ang camera nila. So, minsan I would ask myself, are they still with me? Did I make sense?
Hello!
Ay, nako. Yan yung sinatawag nating increase in the level of cognitive processing done in remote teaching. Kasi, when we are in a video or Zoom teaching, it requires more focus than face-to-face. Kasi sa Zoom teaching, we need to work harder to process those non-verbal cues like the facial expression ng mga estudyante natin. Siyempre, gusto nating malaman kung they are actually affirming kung ano yung sinasabi natin. Yung vocal tone or pitch ng speakers or yung students, yung body language, it consumes a lot of energy and that adds to our cognitive load or additional processing.
Totoo, tama ka dyan, no? Minsan sasabi mo, hello, are you still there? Are you with me? Oh, parang reaction naman dyan, di ba? Nakakapagod din talaga. Alam mo yan yung tinatawag nila ngayong zoomitis. Aside from ano yung zoom fatigue, no? Merong tinatawag na zoomitis. Anyway, Dok Evelie, punta naman tayo dun sa administrative side, no? So, as an administrator, how do you think teachers can be helped so that they're better able to manage the negative impact of remote learning?
Ayun, Dr. Emely, while many of us have webinar fatigue na rin, I believe laking tulong ang mga learning session related to mental health and wellness. It would also help if schools establish mechanisms to support teachers, hindi lang sa pagtuturo, no, but also sa pag-alaga ng kanilang mental health. Schools should remember that teachers are not robots. Kailangan din nila ng pahinga. Hindi lahat carry bells ang 18 hours of work. And so the wellness breaks are really helpful. In addition, minimizing the administrative tasks of basic education teachers should also be considered. Reklamo kasi yan ng marami sa mga ating DepEd teachers.
Alam mo, acknowledge ko yung support ng UPLB sa transition to remote learning and wellness break for teachers, staff, and students. Ramdam na ramdam ko ang kaginhawaan na dinanas after the breaks.
Yeah, I agree. No? Hindi lang yung mga estudyante ang masaya during the wellness break. Tayo din, syempre, ng mga teachers. Pero come to think of it, no, if there are negative impacts, I'm sure there are also positive impacts. Ako, honestly, na-appreciate ko yung remote learning. Kasi I've already found the comforts of my home as conducive for teaching and learning. No? I do not have to travel, so I'm saved or spared from traffic, and syempre yung mga additional expense. So yun naman yung nakita kong positive impact ng remote teaching and learning.
Yeah, so I also became more confident in teaching remotely. Experienced more inclusive education. No? Naging tech savvy in most of us, no? Or tech-informed, no? Collaboration with different sectors to offer solutions to current challenges faced by our students, our teachers, and even our administrators.
Ako naman, I believe I have become more resourceful. I agree that our situation has pushed us to be more collaborative. It's difficult, no, navigating remote teaching and learning all by yourself. So we really have to work with others. At na-force talaga ako to learn more and to be more adaptive and responsive to the needs of my students. I have also become more compassionate while striving to uphold excellence. So thinking about it, I feel I have become a better teacher.
Wow, galing naman. Better teacher. Gusto ko yan. Pero considering the impact remote learning has on teachers, pag-isipan natin, what is now our way forward?
Well, with all the challenges and opportunities we are facing, tayong mga guro should recognize that we are all facing the same challenges. Self-care is important as part of our self-improvement. We may have improved in terms of technology, even teaching strategies, but we should equally equip ourselves on self-care strategies. Be more forgiving, more compassionate to self, and then to others.
I agree, Dr. Monica. Talagang kailangan ang self-care. Sa akin nga eh, kung kailangan mag-declare ng self-care day, ay gawin ko. Kasi para mas maging effective na teacher din ako, di ba?
Oo, I agree. Kailangan talaga yung self-care na yan. And also, for me, no, let's keep exploring ways to make teaching fun and meaningful, regardless of the teaching and learning setup. Soon, we will be returning to face-to-face teaching. But I hope that we'll keep in mind the lessons that we have learned during this remote learning setup and use them to level up the way we teach and manage our learning environment. And yes, I agree with Dr. Monica that we need to prioritize talaga self-care. We can't pour from an empty cup.
Wow, yun ang philosophical. No? We can't pour from an empty cup. But I agree. In today's episode, we focused on the perceived impact of remote teaching and learning to teachers and what can be done to resolve the negative impacts. I'm sure a lot of teachers who are listening to this podcast can relate with the experiences we've shared. In our next episode, we will be discussing a very crucial effect of remote teaching and learning, and that is what we call learning loss or unfinished learning or learning poverty. Thank you for listening once again. Until our next episode of
Let's Talk!